We can do a very simple example so that you get a feeling numerical. Idea, I would have an object here. It has mass m1. And here I have one m2. Let this one have a velocity v1. And this one has a velocity v2. A one-dimensional problem, just as a warm-up. They plow into each other, and they stick together. I put some glue on one, and so they stick together. That's a given. You have to accept that. Let this be the direction of increasing x. And so before the collision, I have a certain amount of momentum. And I can do this on a horizontal table, which is frictionless. I can do it on an ice surface, which is nearly frictionless. And I ignore air drag. So this is the situation before. And so the momentum that I have before equals m1 v1. This is my plus direction. I could put vectors over there, but that's really not necessary because it's a one-dimensional problem, plus m2 v2. But if you like that, be my guest. That's the momentum before. Now they stick together. And so when they stick together, their total mass is m1 plus m2. And then their velocity happens to be v prime. We often give a prime to the situation after the collision occurs. And so now I can apply for the first time the conservation of momentum. The momentum before must be the same as the momentum afterwards, because there are no external forces on the system. When they collide, you better believe it, that there are internal forces. You better believe that there is glue. And it goes plunk, and they feel those forces, both of them. The momentum of each one individually is changing, but not the momentum of the system as a whole. And so this equals m1 plus m2 v prime. And so if we put in some numbers, suppose m1 equals 1 kilogram, and v1 is 5 meters per second. Let m2 be 2 kilograms, and let v2 be 3 meters per second. Then you see, since they're both in the same direction, momentum here is 5 plus 6 is 11. So this is 11. And this is 1 plus 2 is 3. So that is 3 times v1 prime. And so v1 prime is 11/3 meters per second. So the conservation of momentum tells you what the speed is after the collision. When we deal with collisions, the velocities of the object before the collision are unprimed. You see here v1, and you see here v2. Now the velocities after the collisions, by convention, are primed. You see here a v prime. Now if after the collision, object 1 and object 2 have a different velocity, we would call it v1 prime and v2 prime. Now in this case, we're dealing with an inelastic collision. So M1 and M2 are stuck together. They are merged. So it is sufficient to just call it V prime. You could have called it V1 prime because V1 prime is the same as V2 prime, is the same as V prime. And during the next 4 minutes, you will see that a few times do I call it V1 prime. I wish I really hadn't. It would be better if I had just used V prime. That is unique and sufficient. Now, there was a certain amount of kinetic energy before the collision. And of course, we can all calculate that. Kinetic energy before the collision. That is 1/2 m1 v1 squared plus 1/2 m2 v2 squared. 1/2 m1 v1 squared, 1/2 m2 v2 squared. How much is it? You can do that as well as I can. If you add that up, you'll find 21.5 joules. Trivial to stick in the numbers. Now I want to hear from you. What do you think the situation is with the kinetic energy after the collision? Don't look at the numbers. Just use your intuition. It may be wrong. That's okay. My intuition is often wrong. So there was a certain amount of kinetic energy. We had this collision. And I want you to tell me whether you think that the kinetic energy has perhaps increased or decreased, or maybe the kinetic energy hasn't changed. Who thinks the kinetic energy has not changed? Good for you. I see some parents even. Who thinks the kinetic energy has decreased? Even better for you. Hey, there's a professor of physics there. I can't go wrong there. And who thinks the kinetic energy has increased? No one thinks that. Hey, it's amazing. Let's take a look. Kinetic energy after the collision. That would be 1/2 m1 plus m2 times v prime squared. Would we agree? Let me write this at a different location. So this was the 21.5 joules. Well, you can do this as well as I can. We know what V1 prime is, that is 11/3, and you will find that this number equals 20.2 joules. So the kinetic energy went down. Now you may say, well, big deal, a little bit of kinetic energy, and we're like 1.3 joules. Who cares about 1.3 joules? Well, it is a real big deal in physics, let me tell you. And I can make you appreciate that it is a real big deal by doing the following. I don't change the masses, but I just am going to change the direction of the impact. Here is M1, and here is M2. The speeds remain the same, V1, and this is V2. No change in the numbers, except that they go now head on. What is the momentum of particle number one? Well, that is mv. 1 times 5 is plus 5. Remember, this is the increasing direction of x. So the momentum is plus 5. What is the other one? That is 2 times 3. That is 6. Backwards. This is minus 6. So what is the total momentum, if you give it the magnitude, equals minus 1. The magnitude is 1, of course, and the momentum, if I leave this off, we would call that minus 1, because it's a one-dimensional problem. The momentum before is in this direction. It's minus 1. So what now is V prime? They stick together. Here they are. And afterwards, I'm not even sure whether they go this way or this way. Yes, I am sure, because the momentum is in this direction. So I predict that V1 prime will be in this direction. And so this now equals M1 plus M2 times the new V1 prime. Well, M1 plus M2 is 1 plus 2 is 3 kilograms, and so you see that V1 prime equals minus 1/3 meters per second. So the whole system now goes off with 1/3 meters per second in this direction. The kinetic energy before has not changed. It was 21.5 joules, right? That is independent of how I collide them with each other. What now is the kinetic energy afterwards? This is a great tragedy. Because now you get 1/2 the sum of the masses, which is 3, times this small number squared. Goes with V squared, right? And now there is only 0.17 joules left. Almost all kinetic energy has been destroyed. So what you see here in front of your eyes, that kinetic energy can be destroyed, but momentum cannot be destroyed in the absence of external forces. Kinetic energy and momentum is a totally different thing. The momentum of the individual particles did change, but the net momentum did not change, but the kinetic energy was destroyed. I can destroy the kinetic energy completely if I want that. I can arrange a collision so that all kinetic energy has been removed. Suppose this particle has a mass 5 and the velocity is 1. This is my shorthand notation. And this particle has a mass 1, but it has a velocity 5. The momentum of this system is 0. Plus 5 in this direction, and it's 5 in this direction. But you bet your life there is kinetic energy. After the collision, they hit each other. We agreed that they would stick. There was glue on it. Momentum afterwards must therefore still be 0. Internal forces don't matter, no matter what happens. Kinetic energy is 0. So the whole system collides. Bing, and afterwards you have here the sum of the total masses, and it just stands still, because I told you that they are going to stick together. I used glue.